slot, Anne.
So it's a great pleasure to be here. I would like to congratulate Anne, Christian and Rudy for organizing a wonderful event. This has become a bit of a history. I still remember the first time there was a process mining camp in a very small room at the other end of the university. Some of the faces that are here are faces that have been here many years, but it's also good to see many new faces. Many of you have seen me from the MOOC, probably. That is often not the case the other way around. So sometimes I'm in a restaurant and the waiter starts talking to me about process mining, and then I think, So I would love to talk about the very technical things that we are doing, but this is the end of the day, and that would probably be much a bit too tough. So Anne and Christian asked me to ask more about the skills of, somebody that does process mining, also in relation to the uptake of data science. What some of you have noticed is that I have moved location. This is actually a picture that was taken exactly in this room, I think 2 weeks ago or something like that. Then several of my former PhDs gave, I think, wonderful talks, like to celebrate that I was leaving. That was a very nice experience. I started on the 1st of January a new research group at the RWTH in Aachen. So there were several reasons for that move. So the first reason was that my wife finally allowed me to leave Eindhoven. That was the primary reason. I also won the so-called Alexander von Humboldt Professorship, which is the highest German prize that you can win. Also the RWTH in Aachen kind of created, quite unique opportunities for me to move there. Also, the Fraunhofer is sponsoring, in a way, all the research that we are doing. So we have I have a wonderful opportunity to kind of start again, working on many topics. At the same time, of course, I still have many PhDs here that I want to bring to a good end. So several people asked me today already, what are the things that you are working on? And on this slide, I try to summarize that. So one of the things that I would like to continue to work on is the foundations of process mining. I see many spaghetti diagrams. I think it's a term that I invented, I don't know, 15 years ago, that is showing that we still have difficulties capturing reality in a model that is understandable. So there are very, on the one hand, these models should have semantics, they should mean something. At the same time, we should keep things simple. And that remains a challenge. The same is if you go to conformance checking. Are things working the way that it works? This is triggering very tough problems. And I'm surprised by the progress that we have booked over the last couple of years. And I'm very optimistic that each year things will become much better. And then go into commercial tools. The second topic, so XX event data has nothing to do with porn. It means that one of the research lines that I would like to focus on is to get away a bit from the very standard event logs that we typically now need to do process mining. So if you, in several areas, if an event happens, it is not so clear what that event means. So events have uncertainty. It's also that the event data may be so huge that you cannot store it, that you need to do streaming process mining, so process mining on the fly. But there are many other ways, if you apply process mining, that you see that you need to allow for other types of event data than the types of event data that we look at today. So that's a research line. Then a research line sponsored by the Fraunhofer, where there will be a separate research group, is on what is called here automated operational process improvement. That is the dream that I think many of you have. So process mining is saying what my problems are, but what should I do, right? And there is, of course, no free lunch. There is a lot of work already done in, for example, predicting what will happen to a running case in terms of remaining processing time, what the path is that will be taken, etc., etc. That's not what I mean when I say this. I talk more about the process design, the organization of people, etc., etc. So of course you need to inject domain knowledge. Yeah, so that's why I say it's not a free lunch. You, as a, let's say, process owner, you need to say what your constraints are. And that's something that we do not do in process mining yet. We push a button and we have a model that is hopefully showing the problems that we have, and then we should get ideas. And I would like to change that a bit. The last part, and I think it very nicely relates to the last talk, there is a lot of resistance, and the resistance is growing against the use of data. One possible solution is to think of all kinds of stricter laws, as have been just introduced in Europe, but I do not think that that is the solution. So if you would consider, let's say, data science like mobility, you cannot be against data science, the use of data. You cannot be against mobility. What you should be against is the pollution that it is creating, the negative side effects. So you can have a law, okay, you should no longer drive, but that's not the point. I think we should have laws that are more precisely describing what is, let's say, good for society and what is bad for society, and then there should be smart algorithms. So we are working on algorithms, for example, where we do process mining, where the process graphs that come out of it look exactly the same, but nobody knows the event data. Or if you make conclusions out of process mining and they are unfair, that the system is warning for it. So for example, if I take the hospital case, suppose that we would analyze, okay, which doctor operates the most people that actually die. Yeah? Then you could say, okay, that doctor, that's the bad guy. Most of the people are dying on his table, so we should blame him. But if you would analyze the data a bit further, you would probably see that that is the most experienced and the best doctor there is. And I think that's often mistakes that we make if we do process analysis, that we see only part of the story and we just look at the very simple metric. And we should think of ways of protecting people against these types of conclusions, otherwise resistance of society will become too big. So this is a bit what we are planning to work on. So now I would like to go more to the area of data science, what a data scientist and a process miner should be able to do. So it is still surprising for me, on the one hand, let's say data science is very old. On the other hand, you suddenly see that it is everywhere. And the metaphor that I like to use is that it has been a bath that has been filling with water for many, many years. So we were doing process mining. We started doing here in Eindhoven process mining in the late 90s. There was hardly any data. But we were thinking about these ideas, and let's say the bath was filling, and what we have seen in the last 5 years is that suddenly the bath is overflowing. So data is everywhere. We have smartphones, we store things in the cloud, etc., etc. Suddenly there are lots of opportunities to apply these types of technologies. And that's why it's very important that people are able to use this data in a meaningful way. So this is a picture that I made in 2012 when I established together with some other people the Data Science Center here in Eindhoven. So for the people that are not from Eindhoven, the Data Science Center Eindhoven is probably one of the largest concentration of data science researchers in the Netherlands, with over 400 researchers in this area. And I had to create a diagram that would somehow capture what are now the people that are in the data science center. What are their capabilities? Also, if I would go to companies. And I made this picture in 2012. Many similar pictures followed by many others after that. For me, it seems like decades ago, but that illustrates probably how fast the field is moving in all kinds of ways. So what you see here is you see the typical ingredients of a data science curriculum, databases, machine learning, etc., etc., but also things like visualization, privacy, security, etc., etc. Yeah, so this is a kind of flower, and you could discuss what should be exactly in it, but there are ingredients, I think, that everybody can understand this is part of any data science curriculum or the capabilities that the person should have. Another way to view it is to look at the data science pipeline. And there you have three basic areas. The first area is, let's say, infrastructure. That is, let's say, the plumbing of data science. That is making it work, working with large amounts of data, being able to store things efficiently, retrieve things efficiently, etc., etc. Distributing things. Then the middle part is the part that I think many of you are talking about or thinking about when you think about process mining. It's very much in the middle. You have the data, you have the processing capabilities. How can you use them to produce interesting results? And then there is this part of effect that is relating to this responsible data science, where we look at, for example, what are business models, how about privacy, how about security, ethics, and these types of things. So if I look at the flower and I relate them, I think the link is quite obvious. So for example, sometimes it's surprising that if you have a process mining algorithm and it takes hours to do something, then you have a very clever idea to change the way that you think about the problem, and then it is handled in milliseconds. And these are things that are happening at the algorithmic level. At the same time, there are major advances in database technology, distributed systems. And so many people thought 15 years ago that there would be no research in database systems anymore, that it was finished. Like how wrong they could be. Look at the value of, let's say, database experts today, and it shows that this is still a very important topic. Oops, that was too fast. So if you look at analysis, then you can see that most of the things are related to that. It goes from statistics to mining to visualization, etc. And last but not least, we have this these things that are about the effect. What does, if we do data science, what kind of effect does that have on people and society and business models? Then we look at these aspects. So I established, together with, let's say, the leading data science groups in the Netherlands, we established this initiative, responsibledatascience.org, which is an initiative to think about, let's say, this green data science that I was describing before. That's like the dream that we would like to make happen. So I showed you basically my pictures, one that I made a very long time ago, the other one that I made a few years ago. So how do others look at this? And then you can see many pictures. So if you look at this picture, and I added all the references of the people that made the pictures, so this looks very scary. And so I thought that I had some understanding of data science, but I have difficulty understanding half of the things that are here. So it is covering many different topics. And I think that's a general pattern that you see if you look at the profile of a data scientist, that there are many different things, from foundations to statistics to big data technology to ethics, and all of these things are there. And so it is I like this picture very much. And so it shows that you should have analytical skills. A good data science should also have some programming skills. Also soft skills are, of course, very important, and people should be able to communicate the results. So that is the typical profile of the data scientist, and you can see that the person that has these type of capabilities, people are fighting for that, because that person would be like a one-man army being able to do all of these things. But of course, it is very difficult to kind of have people that look like this. And so these are pictures that were made in the context of a workshop that we had here in 2014, where we discussed the capabilities of the data scientist already. And what is always striking is that it has this, on the one hand, technical skills, on the other hand, also soft skills. And that's a combination that is desirable, but at the same time also very difficult. Then you have these types of diagrams that show all kinds of intersections. And it's kind of funny to see that all different intersections always lead to data science. Yeah, so if you look domain expertise, mathematics and computer science, you get data science. And if you look at mathematics, business and information systems, you also get data science. And there are many of more of such diagrams. There are also diagrams that are indicating that things are dangerous. Like if you have hacking skills and you have, let's say, domain knowledge, then you're a very dangerous person. And again, data science is in the middle. So this is showing that we expect a lot of things of a data scientist. So it's like, as we say in Dutch, een schaap met vijf poten, so a sheep with five legs. You're looking for something that is very, very rare. So the data scientist looks a bit depressing here. And it is especially depressing because he or she was promised to be the most sexy person of the century. So that's a bit disappointing. So this shows that to really work in this area, you need to really try to combine skills. And it takes a lot of effort to really acquire these skills. There is no free lunch in that. So in the next phase, I would like to comment a bit on the terms that are being used. And I think it's for you as ambassadors of process mining, you also have a role to kind of correct your environment if they are using terms in a very, let's say, sloppy or inconsistent way. So there are incredible expectations related to AI and terms like big data, etc., etc. So that is very dangerous because we already had several AI winters. And probably not all the people in the audience know that. But already in the past, there were periods like this, that AI was expected to solve all of our problems. And then it turned out that they could solve certain problems and not other problems. And then people were very disappointed by that. And you can see that there have been very various waves where this is. And of course, for our poor sheep with five legs, this is very, very tough. Yeah? So what I would like to stress is that we should be careful about the terms that we are using. And if you look at the newspapers, this is very difficult. So this was just a random selection of news items that I took. And for example, there you can see how AI can help you to remain sober. Right? So you can make any sentence and put AI in front of it and you will find something about it. And I think this is, let's say, not realistic. We are today we looked at all kinds of talks analyzing event data. Event data is, on the one hand, you could say it's relatively easy, but it's generating very specific and very difficult problems, and you need to be very careful on how to apply it. And people that are promising these types of things, they are simply telling nonsense. So if you would look at the landscape of terms, and you should take this picture with a grain of salt, it's my personal opinion, and perhaps the size of the bubbles, you could argue about that. But I see a clear distinction between artificial intelligence, machine learning, and of course there is an overlap. There is the classical field of data mining, which has been incredibly successful. Nobody talks about data mining, everybody applies it. But if people today talk about the decision tree, they don't talk about data mining, they call it artificial intelligence. And it has nothing to do with each other. Then there is this the spectacular success of deep learning. So deep learning using deep neural networks that suddenly could do all kinds of things that were very difficult before. So the progress is very impressive. So I'm in Aachen, let's say two floors below me is a professor called Professor Nij. And he is studying, let's say, how can you recognize speech and how can you translate, let's say, sentences. So Google Translate was basically built by his PhDs. So if you look at his PhDs, all of them work at Amazon, Google, or they have their own company. It's an incredible success, but in a very specific area. Speech recognition, translation, for example, recognizing images, recognizing movement, etc., etc. So it's very respectable that this success was there, but it has not so much to do with the types of problems that we have been discussing here today. And therefore it's, I would like to disambiguate these types of things. So you could argue process mining is data mining, but then you would look at the techniques and they are very different than the things that you find in data mining tools. So saying that process mining is part of data mining or AI or something like that doesn't make any sense. So this is my view. If my pointer works, yeah. If I now look at what is the feeling that I get if I look in the media and if I look at how big technology companies are promoting things, is that AI is more or less the same as machine learning, is more or less the same as deep learning. Everything is solved, right? We do not need process mining algorithms anymore. We have a deep neural network. We just put an event log in it and a process model comes out. So where are these algorithms? There is not a single algorithm in this space that is able to discover a process model. And so it doesn't exist for very specific tasks, like for example, predicting the remaining processing time of a case, predicting the path. Of course, you can use deep neural networks. The problem is a bit that you typically need to have much more data to get comparable results to, let's say, the classical techniques. But that's a very narrow area where you can actually apply this. Yeah, so recognizing a picture or talking to Siri or Alexa is something different than mining a process model. That's what I'm trying to explain. So if we look at the field of process mining, it is basically combining these capabilities that we see in the area of data science and the things that we see in the area of process science. So if you, like for data science, I elaborate about quite a bit about that. I will not tell so much about process mining, but the question, it's like an open question that I will rephrase later, is a bit, what do you need to know about process science to be able to do a process mining project? Do you need to know what a PetriNet is? Right? Do you need to know what an invariant is? Do you need to know what a Markov chain is? Do you need to know what BPMN models are? UML state charts, etc., etc. Like, it's an open question and it's not so clear. The same as with the data science thing, what are now exactly the skills that are there? But you should be aware that if you are missing some of the basics, there are certain things that you can do and there are other things that you cannot do. And you should understand that some of these things are not there just for fun. They have a reason that they are there. Yeah, so process mining is trying to manage these two areas, making it even more challenging for the sheep with five legs to be able to cover all of these things, right? So normally I would now show slides of, let's say, beautiful techniques that we have developed to do process mining. I don't need to do that. You've seen many things before. Perhaps to reflect a bit on this is that if you look at the progress in process mining, then if you look forward, you have the feeling it goes very slow. If you look backward and you read the scientific papers of, let's say, 15 years ago, you realize that there has been incredible progress. At the same time, and that is, I think, what some of you do not realize, is that many of the questions and the ideas that are now appearing were actually already, for example, described in Anne Rosinat's thesis. So, for example, we saw a talk by Microsoft earlier today about predicting the remaining time, predicting the path. So there is a whole bunch of algorithms developed, let's say 10 years ago, to solve exactly that question. So for me, it is very interesting to see that with some delay, things are considered to be too abstract. And then 10 years later, they are suddenly in products and suddenly work. Okay, so back to the skills needed. I've been referring a bit to this problem. To drive a car, do you need to know how a car actually works internally? And the answer is not so clear. So here I talk about the powertrain, that is the engine and the connection to the wheels, etc., etc. So do you need to know how a car internally works to be able to drive it? Yeah? And that's not a yes-no question. I think it depends. Like, if you would like to drive the fastest time around the Nürburgring, I think it can be useful to know that you know how a car works. Also, if you need to select a car, and I think many of, at least a part of the audience is selecting cars, it's not just driving cars, but also selecting cars, then it is useful that you know how such a car works internally. It's also, process mining is a relatively young technology, and because it's a relatively young technology, it is not just about driving the car. Like selecting the car and understanding how it works, I think is important. So I'm encouraging you to look deeper than just pushing a button and looking at the diagrams. Of course, it doesn't make any sense to try to deny, let's say, that these capabilities are actually there and just forget about the possibilities that exist anyway, right? But to understand the possibilities, you need to understand a bit how this car works internally. So if we go to jobs in the future, I think we are in both an exciting and also a scary time. And there are many reports like this one that are basically predicting what is going to happen to the way that people work and what kind of jobs still exist in 10 or 20 years and what jobs do not exist. And I think it's very much related to the topic of process mining in two ways. It is about how we can think about improving processes, knowing that there are these developments, but also how our profession itself is changing and what the requirements are upon us to do these types of jobs. So this is a very interesting report. I think it appeared earlier this year. There are all kinds of diagrams, and what many of these reports see is that they see several waves of automation. So you see certain jobs that basically have already disappeared now or that will disappear in 5 years. And so if you walk here back to the train station, then there is a big tower on the left-hand side. That is the call center of KPN. I think there are 1,000 people working there, I'm just guessing. I'm not sure whether there will be any people in this building in 5 or 10 years, right? Because it will all be replaced by intelligent agents and other means. Other jobs, it will take a bit longer, and that's why these waves are identified. As you can see, I chose a very safe job. Like, if you are in education, you have the lowest probability of being automated by something else. What you see is that many of the, I think, the organizations that you work for and that you represent are somewhere in the middle. So at some point in time, this is going to happen. There's another study, this is slightly older, and you should take all of these reports with a grain of salt, of course. They make you think about what is going to happen, and I think that's the value that you see here. This is a report by Oxford University that will say that, okay, 47% of our jobs are endangered in the future. And here you can see, yeah, if you are a social worker or a firefighter, you are relatively safe. But if you are an accountant or an auditor or you handle tax declarations, then your job will disappear. Yeah? And again, you should take it with a grain of salt, but this is what is happening. And I think for everybody in the room, it is very important to think about, yeah, what are the skills that are required from me as a, I don't know, as a process miner or a data scientist or a BBPM expert. I think all of these jobs, they will not stop immediately, but the nature of these jobs will change. Yeah, so, for example, if you look in auditing, you can see that there is still a high resistance against, let's say, very data science-oriented techniques. Yeah, this is resistance is very strong, but we all know that it is going to end. It cannot stay the way that it stays now. It's the same as that you would look at, I don't know, a place where you can rent videos. Okay, these places survived for a couple of years, but you know that logic will tell that these things will close. So I think many jobs will change. I think it's not just about cost and efficiency, it's also about quality, that society expects us to do things in a more analytical manner, and I think this is inevitable. So that is good news for process miners, but at the same time we see that process mining is not, like on the one hand, like in the Netherlands, I think it's very successful, but if you go to the US, I think most of the people do not know that it actually exists. So why is this not a bigger success? I think on the one hand, there is a delay. On the other hand, and I think that there are many people having a lot of experience with that, is that it still takes an incredible amount of time to just get the data in the right quality, etc., etc. So this is something that has to change, and it is also something that will change. It is not a constant. In 10 years, the world will look, in my view, completely different. So I think that many of these things will not hold, I don't know, in 10 or 20 years from now. So having said that, we can think of what are now typical profiles for people working in the area of process mining. And I'm going to use two dimensions. The first dimension is basically a bit of a refinement of the structure that I showed before. If you do process mining, you need to spend time on preparing the data, extracting the data, cleaning it, etc., etc. You need to spend time on the actual analysis, and you need to interpret the results that your process mining tool gives to you. Right? There you see the various terms under that. So this is one dimension, and it is not so simple as we have seen to today. So we can look at these models, and the first time that people look at these models, they are very impressed that you can do that. But very often when people start looking further, it is not so clear and not so so easy as it seems. Yeah, so what can I conclude from such a diagram? So for example, we see this change PR approval happened 61 times, 20 through in, 29 out. So what happened to the rest, right? These are questions that you probably need to deal with every day, but which are very difficult, let's say, to explain and to make sure that people have trust and believe the outcome of process mining. You need to be very clear about this. If you leave it vague, then later in the process you will get into trouble. So it's not so easy, and I think like all the parties need to invest time in kind of really understanding what these diagrams mean, and also what the predictive value is. And so earlier I referred to the work that we were doing on, let's say, predicting paths and predicting the remaining flow time. There are many algorithms available today, but the problem is not so much that the algorithms are not good enough, but that there is not enough signal in the data to make reliable conclusions. So there are certain limits that you should be very careful about predicting things on certain types of data. So this is the spectrum that I was describing. So on the one hand, we have prepare, analyze, interpret, the different phases. On the one hand, you have people, let's say like me, that just care about the data science part and the technologies behind it. And there are, of course, the people that care very much about the problem, the company, the business, how does it provide value to a particular organization. So what kind of person do we need? Well, the person we would like to have is this person that is basically able to cover this entire diagram. But I think there are very few of such sheep. What is more realistic, I think, is this situation, where you need to think, okay, people have different capabilities and we should respect these capabilities, and we should also be aware that there are certain things that we do not understand. So these diagrams are basically intended to make you think a bit about, okay, what is the profile that you have, the profile that you expect other people to have, and how do these interfaces work? So this would be the process mining expert, very much on the data science technology, able to do the whole pipeline. The domain expert knows about the data, knows about the questions, can interpret results, but has very little knowledge of, let's say, how process mining really works from the inside. But there are probably more variable profiles, like, for example, this profile. So the person that is able to interpret the data, perhaps not do all the extraction, etc., etc., but then is more on the right-hand side of the diagram. Another profile could be this. So somebody that is a process mining expert, but that is specializing in analysis in a particular domain. So my question to you would be, where are you now? Where would you like to go? And I think that's the goal that Anne had that I would talk a bit about. So thank you very much for your attention. You know where to find me at my new location. And thank you.